object-oriented analysis and design. Oh, you want to ask the question? Okay, go ahead.
What do you think, like you always recommend us to read books, so what do you think that books have other sources that don't have, like articles, like online courses, and so on?
Okay, the question is why I recommend books instead of recommending YouTube courses or maybe blog posts or maybe Coursera studies or something, I don't know. Well, I believe that books are the best sources, better than Wikipedia, better than any blogs, because they are the most difficult content to produce for the authors. I also wrote 5 books in my life, and I know that each book is a big investment of time, and when you write a book, you need to be much more systematic and much more responsible for your result than comparing to writing a blog or making a YouTube or making a lecture like this. So in the book, you feel responsible, and that's why you cover everything, well, as much as you can. And that's why reading these books will give you the knowledge, the best knowledge you can get from anywhere. So that's why I recommend books. I think they're the best sources of information. And the more books you write, you read, the more professional programmers you will become. So you need to spend, I think, most of your free time right now when you study on reading books. After that, you will have much less time. When you start working and making money, going to the office every day, they will give you tasks. There will be interesting tasks. You will spend all your free time on coding, on producing things. So now is the time of study, and you need to read what you read. You read books. So I would not, being you, I would not trust much to lectures, the teachers, because we are just, we give you, I don't know, 5% or maybe 1% of what of the real knowledge which exists in the market. So how much can I give you in these 16 lectures comparing to, you see how many books I recommend. On every lecture, I give you at least 2 books. Sometimes I gave you 6 on the previous one. So 6 books, and I talk to you for 90 minutes. 90 minutes and 6 books, it's incomparable. So how much I can give you in these 90 minutes? I can only highlight you certain things. I can only give you the highlights, but I cannot give you the full knowledge. So you absolutely need to read them, yeah. Yes. Yes, the question is about books which can be outdated, which can be too old for the things that we develop, because right now the technologies, they change fast, and books are, they stay like, and for example, the books which I show, some of them are like 15 years old, so they're pretty old, and maybe sometimes even 40 years old, so how they are relevant to the things we do right now? Well, I believe that I'm trying to show you the books which are relevant. As you see, I don't show you the books about Java. I don't show you books about C++, usually. I don't show you books about practical, like about some languages or practical things, which will be outdated. Because we're recording this video, and the video will be on YouTube, and in 5 years, somebody will stumble upon this video. They will watch it, they will see books which are outdated. They will close the video, because information is outdated. So I'm giving you the books which, in my time, have no time of expiration, so they will be with us forever. For example, these books by Robert Martin or Martin Fowler, they are still very much accurate, and they're still with us, and the information they gave is very much along the things we do now. Of course, there are many books which expire the next year, something like in JavaScript. Read the book about JavaScript, which is 3 years old. Today, it's no use of this book. Or read the book about some framework, some AngularJS. You read the book, next year it's a completely different framework. You just throw away the book. These books I don't recommend you. I recommend you something which you can read in 5 years without no problem. Okay? Market, we have structured programming. Who knows what is structured programming? If, then, else, while, procedure, function. That's functional, that's structured programming. Languages like C, Pascal, Those are the languages. Case means computer-aided software engineering. That was the idea that we can develop software with moving the mouse and putting pieces together with this user computer. And we had waterfall. So I put these things, it's completely informal, that's my understanding. So I put these things in the before section and then after section. So what happened? We got object-oriented programming, we got C++, Object, Pascal, Java, and we got Rust. Basically agile as well here. So you can put it as well in the agile. So that happened. So what am I going to tell you about? First, we will discuss the model, the object model, basically object-oriented programming by Grady, Booch, and other people, what it is, what's there. Then we'll discuss solid principles by Uncle Bob. Who knows solid design principles? There you go. And you say you don't know Robert Martin. That's the author of solid principles. Then we're going to talk about design by contract by Bertrand, Meyer, a little briefly. I'm not a deep expert.
You know Bertrand, right?
Say it again?
He taught us
to there you go. So you know what it is. I'll just briefly say what I know about this because he knows much better. Then I will say a few words about the principle called DRY. Do you know about this one? Okay, good. Then we'll talk about YAGNI principle. You know about this one as well? Okay, you know everything.
Then we'll talk about inversion of control. Do you know this one? There you go. And we'll talk about, I will a little bit compare object-oriented
programming with functional programming. Some of you asked about that, so I will say a few words about functional programming. And then books, venues, and call to action. That's the structure of the lecture. Okay, let's go.
Object model by Grady Booch. Grady Booch was the main, actually, the author, and there are many other people. So what is object model? What's the difference between procedural programming and object-oriented programming? On the left, you see procedural programming. On the right, you see object-oriented programming.
Procedural programming is when you have procedures, functions, and you have data. The functions are more or less isolated from each other. This is one function, another function, another function. For example, this function can sort the list, sort an array. This function can print the array. This function can remove the same elements from the array. This function can save the array to the database. Those are the functions. And the array goes through function to function. You get the array, you pass it to the function, then you pass it to another function, then you pass it to another function. So it's a collection of functional procedures. Let's call them procedures or functions. Object-oriented programming, the idea was new. They suggested that how about we encapsulate the data. So we put this array into an object, and then we're not going to give this data to another procedure, to another procedure. We will let the object talk to another object, no matter what it means, and we'll discuss what it means. But they suggested to create objects which hide the data inside, so the data doesn't move anymore from procedure to procedure. The data stays inside the object, and objects talk to each other. How they talk, that's a big question. But usually they basically, again, they send each other the same data. So that's why, because the idea looks interesting, like objects, they talk to each other, data stays inside the object, so data never goes out, the array is inside the object, and then the object talks to other objects, sending some messages, information, so they communicate like living organisms, so they're like alive, but in reality, the same array goes the same direction. Anyway, there are four principles of object-oriented design. Actually, there are more principles. So I made a list of some principles of object-oriented programming. On the left, you see the principles suggested by Grady Booch, who wrote the book, which is called Object-Oriented Analysis and Design. It's abstraction, encapsulation, modularity, and hierarchy. Four principles. But later, these principles were extended. Some other principles were suggested, like composition, like inheritance, like subtyping, data hiding, many, many names, and you can find many more. So object-oriented programming is not a science, unfortunately. Object-oriented programming is the set of ideas which anyone can change. Many people introduce their own ideas. Some people think that abstraction is one thing, and subtyping is one thing, so and other people think differently. So it's very informal, unfortunately. But some principles are well, like it's still an encapsulation, for example. Many people argue about what is encapsulation and what do we exactly understand by encapsulation. So all of these principles are not so so strict. So abstraction, principle number one, abstraction. What is abstraction? Who actually think that he or she can explain what is abstraction? Raise your hand. One. I cannot say that, to be honest. So by abstraction, they mean that there are many definitions of abstraction, but the idea is that you, instead of letting us deal with specific things, you let us deal with abstract things.
So for example, I say, give me
a chair. No, I say, give me this chair. This is a specific thing. And I say, give me a chair so I can sit. This is abstract thing. So that's abstraction and non-abstraction. So specific request or specific interaction between objects, it's a bad idea, it's a bad thing. A good thing is deal with abstract things. Like, give me something which can look, or give me something which looks like a database connection, or give me something which looks like a like an array. Don't give me this array, but give me something that looks like an array. This is abstraction. So we abstract the things we deal with and do it usually through classes and through, and then goes the polymorphism. So for example, look at this shape and rectangle and triangle. So shape is something which is a definition of some shape. And since it's Java, it says it's abstract. So it's shape which doesn't have any specific implementation now. It's just shape. It's just something which looks like a shape for us. And for example, it has a method which is called getArea. So, oh, for example, it has color. Let's look at the getArea. So shape is something that I can talk to, and its shape, this shape will tell me something about the area. So maybe I am a circle, or I am a rectangle, or I am the chair of this height, or I am the black chair, or I am the white chair. So like in my example, like, give me the chair. They give you the chair, and then you ask,
hey, chair, what's your color? And the chair says, I'm black. Oh, I'm surprised. Okay, good. I didn't ask for a black chair. I just asked for a chair. And then the chair is delivered,
and I ask, like, who are you? What are your details? And the chair says, I have four legs. And I say, oh, nice. I didn't ask for four legs, but it's nice you have four of them. The same here. I say, give me the shape, and the shape is delivered, and I start talking to the shape. And I say, what's your area?
I say, get area. So I call the man of get area. And all of a sudden, this is rectangle.
And I say, oh, that's nice, you're a rectangle. I didn't know about that. So this is called polymorphism. Polymorphism. It means that something that is delivered to me can take many forms. Polymorphism. So it takes many forms. It can be a rectangle, it can be triangle, whatever it is. For me, it doesn't matter because I accept all the possible forms. I accept rectangle, I accept triangle. Why? Because I accept shape. So me, for me as a customer, as a client, it's okay to say, send me whatever it is, as long as it's shape. And then I say, and then the declaration of this abstract thing goes in Java through abstract classes or through interfaces. In Swift, there's protocols. Who knows Swift? In C++, there are just classes. In Ruby, there's nothing. In JavaScript, there is nothing for that, right? Yeah, because in Java, they don't have the specific thing to define this interface, to define this abstract thing, which I can expect to get. So abstraction is a good idea in object-oriented programming. So we can isolate the customer who accepts the information from the provider. So the provider is now free to design any chair they want. They can do white chair, they can do three legs chair, they can do tall chair, they can do small chair, whatever, as long as it's okay for me to get a chair. So it's more freedom for the customer. The customer is not connected to me. That's how we make architecture, which is more modular. We can easily decouple us. You know, decoupling, that's the idea of the, we will discuss it in the last lecture, but now you need to understand that.
Coupling is a bad thing. So when we stay close to each other, me and the maker of the chair,
then it's very bad for the whole design. Because we're together, it's difficult to get us disconnected. It's difficult to make us modular. It's difficult to scale up this system when we're connected too much. So the one of the biggest discussed on the previous lecture, modularity. To achieve the modularity, you make things decoupled. And decoupling you get by abstraction. Because I say, I want to deal with abstract chairs. I don't want to deal with specific chairs. I deal with just chairs. And then it makes a lot of freedom for those who provide me the chairs. So that's one object-oriented design is to make objects abstract. And then goes polymorphism. This picture actually shows, just explains more what I said before. It's, if you look at this design, on the top, on the middle, we have interface. And the interface says something displayable. Something displayable. And there are implementations. There could be a circle, triangle, or rectangle. All of them are displayable things. And then the user has a collection. You see, that's an array of displayable things. So the user is dealing with abstract things. The user doesn't care what are those displayable things. This is the line, the red line shows the decoupling, the line of decoupling. So for the user, it doesn't matter who are these people, who are these objects, whatever, your rectangle, your triangle, whatever. The user only has an array of displayable things. That's all the user wants to know. So the user deals with abstractions. We have one abstraction, displayable, and those three concrete implementations. So those are specifics, this is the abstraction.
That's good. The more you have like this, the better.
If your design, if in your design, your class expects another class to be specific, like give me, I only accept HTTP request that like implement, like I accept a class, not an interface, not an abstract class, then it's your design is not so modular.
Second thing is encapsulation.
Design or encapsulation? You see there's a capsule. So encapsulation, the word is coming from the word capsule. So I got this picture on the internet actually a few days ago. I didn't know about this visual representation of encapsulation. So they suggest that that's the idea of object-oriented programming, that we can encapsulate things that other people don't need to see. So when I design a chair, I don't disclose the information of how this chair is made. You wanted the chair, here's the chair for you. I don't tell you what kind of color, what kind of paint I was using to paint the chair. I'm not telling you what's the material I made this chair of. I'm not telling you how much it costs me. I just give you the chair. You wanted the chair, here it is. Three legs, white color, price is $10. That's it. How much I spent, how did I paint it, it doesn't matter for you. The same for object-oriented programming.
So you have a class user or a class car or a
class triangle. What's inside, it doesn't matter for you. Do I connect to the database in order to show you the data? It's none of your concern. Do I go to the memory? Do I do some very heavy calculations in order to provide the data? It's none of your concern. So I encapsulate everything inside the object. They didn't have it before in procedural programming. More things were quite open. So it was the responsibility of the user to go through one procedure to another, moving data from here to here and knowing everything about the data. These days we have capsules, and this capsule is called object, and inside this object we keep everything there, like the data, functionality, everything. For example, look at this class, they say data members, methods, behavior, variables, methods. The picture is quite specific, variables, members, maybe there's something else, but the general idea is this. So when you design your class, make sure that nobody from the outside has any access to what's inside the class. Don't disclose them this information.
Hide this information inside. Make your class untouchable.
That's encapsulation. Encapsulation goes along with the concept of data hiding. So basically we want to hide the data. We don't want the data to be seen outside. Again, look at the picture. It's a capsule with the members, member variables, member functions. Something is private, something is public. I don't think that the implementation of encapsulation is good in modern programming languages like in C++ or Java. I think that we, with this so primitive approach to encapsulation, like private and public, we didn't implement what was expected to be in the area of encapsulation. I actually wrote a blog post like 5 years ago, which is called Encapsulation Covers Up Naked Data. And I'll show you what it means in the blog post. You can read it, but look at this Java class. The temperature,
the private attribute t, and then you get the method get t, and then the method set t. So this is the class which represents the temperature. So do you think I encapsulate the data properly? We still have the getters, we still have the setters. But Java thinks I encapsulate everything well because I have private attribute. So if you ask like the classic classic approach to Java, they will tell you that you encapsulate. Hey, look, take a look back. I got it from internet. Look, they think that what's blue is public, what's yellow, what's white is private. So I made it private.
Good. I did everything right. But no.
So Java actually didn't help me to design the software right, to design my class right. It's still no encapsulation. I still let the data jump out. And I call it naked data, so it's not covered. So the data jumps out and then we don't know what's going to happen with the data. So it's a bad idea to let the data jump out of your class.
It's much better that you deal with the data inside the class. Here's the example, again from my blog post. Another class temperature, also the private attribute T. But now look, I don't let you get the T out.
You want the temperature as a string? I'll print a string for you. So don't take T from me, because I don't want you to get my data. It's my data. What do you want, the text? You want my data to, you want to know what's me, what is me in the way of the text? I will give you this information. But don't expect me to let you, you know, take my data and use it as a raw, in the raw format.
But what is the point if you can get the raw format of the data from the format you will present to the user?
Again?
So what is the point, for example, here you are not giving the user data in the raw format.
Yes.
But what is the point if still the user can get the raw format out of the format you will
present? Okay, you're saying that user can get the two string and then from the two string extract the number. Yes? Yeah, of course the user can abuse that, of course they can do that, but in a proper way the user should not do that. But with the first example, all users will just use the data, use the naked data. And you can read the blog post, I explained there that why it's a problem. And it's not my idea why it's a problem. The problem with the data is that if users will take this raw data, this naked data from the objects, then they will make some assumptions about the data. So that's the core problem. So let's, for example, tomorrow somebody will use the class temperature, will take the T out and think, oh, that's probably Celsius. So probably the temperature is in Celsius, right? They will assume that.
Nobody says that. The documentation says nothing about that. So one part of the system will assume
that the temperature is in Celsius. Another part of the system, also having no information about it, we'll take the naked data and assume, oh, this is Fahrenheit. It's a different system of measuring temperature. There will be two assumptions in this system, in two parts of the system. And they will design their software based on these two assumptions.
One day, they will meet, and there will be a bug. And they will ask, okay, how do we fix that bug?
One part, a huge part of the system, is already assuming that this is Celsius, another part assuming something else. And that's just a simple example with the temperature. Imagine what may happen, and it happens everywhere, where people rely on naked data. They just take data from all the classes and then deal with this data, instead of letting those classes hide the data. That's a huge problem. We cannot discuss it next time, next lectures, and next, we'll get back to it again and again. It's all about object orientation, which is broken. The idea of object orientation was good originally, but the implementation which is made in programming languages is not strong enough. Look at this example. So programming languages, they let us design in the wrong way. They let the data jump out and then let the people get coupled with this data and so on and so forth.
Don't you think this happens? It's not a problem of program because you use it in the wrong way, per se. Like, it's not the problem of the concept itself, it's a problem of the program.
Yes, of course, it's not the problem of a programming language, you're saying it's a problem of a bad programmer, right, who made the mistakes. But how many good programmers we have? We have millions of bad programmers, and we have languages which allow programmers to make those mistakes. That's why I'm saying this, object orientation is broken. Because object orientation was a high level idea. Let's
do abstraction, let's do encapsulation, let's do polymorphism.
And then, okay, and then here's C++ for you. And nobody knows what to do, because in C++ you can do anything. I can do encapsulation or I can do no encapsulation. How do I know which one is right? I don't know. I'm just a programmer. I just need to finish my day or my, you know, my work today and go home. So I don't do encapsulation. I don't even know whether it's encapsulation. Look at this example. I'm the junior programmer. I read the book. I know that saying private means encapsulation. I say private. That's it. And I call it a day. And then the code gets bad. So this is encapsulation. So encapsulation
doesn't work. It's just an idea. Modularity. Number three, modularity. Modularity means, again, this is the principle of object orientation, is that we say here that on the left you see non-modular software, on the right you see modular software. What exactly it means technically I cannot say, but the picture on the left doesn't look right, the picture on the right looks right. So we need to, in object orientation, we need to try to put classes, blocks of code, components in modules. And these modules have to be connected to each other through
small amount of connections. So modularity goes together, goes in line, you know, side by side with decoupling. So we want modules to be decoupled as much as possible. They shouldn't stay,
they shouldn't overlap, they shouldn't be connected as much as they are connected in the left picture.
They have to be modularly isolated as much as possible from each other. This is modularity. It's a quality of object orientation. Before object orientation, we didn't have that. Before, we had procedures everywhere. Data were coming from procedure to procedure. And it was very hard to say, where are the modules? Because one procedure calls another procedure, then this procedure calls another one, and then they call each other through the circle. Like, where is the, who is the module? It was hard to say. With object orientation, it's easy, much more easier if the design is right. Then it's easier to say, because one object may encapsulate other objects, but the border of the object can be defined much more with much more explicitness.
And the final one is hierarchy. Hierarchy means that
here we have the hierarchy of inheritance. Inheritance is yet another quality, yet another principle of object orientation, is where we have the person, and then the employee is the person. And then the student is also a person, and then the
faculty member is also an employee. You understand hierarchy, right? It's quite obvious. However, many people don't. And I'm sure that
not all of you would also say that, will be able to say that I never make mistakes with encapsulation. What happens in real object orientation world is that it doesn't look like a hierarchy, but people start making a graduate a parent of a person. It happens a lot. So on this picture, it's quite clear. It's a book example. Like, we know, okay, the graduate is this a student, and student is a person. But in real life, it's going to be not a student or a person. It will be HTTP request, database raw. It will be some observable item on the screen, and then and everything and everything. And eventually, you get into the situation where all classes inherit each other with no real hierarchy. So the hierarchy, if you meet the software in the real world, if you meet the software which looks like this hierarchy, you're super lucky. In the real world, you will have a mess, the network of classes, and they all inherit each other somehow like this. So it will be very hard for you to find out the real hierarchy. So hierarchy, if we have this hierarchy like this, it's a very good object-oriented system, because it's easy to deal with that, because it's a clear abstraction. You deal with the person, so you can ignore everything which goes below the person. If you deal with the student, then you ignore everything that goes below the student. I just say, I need a student, that's all. I don't care which kind of student it is. So hierarchy is a good thing.
Now let's talk a little bit about this inheritance thing. So
who knows about this claim that inheritance is worse than composition? So composition is a good replacement for inheritance. You should read about that. Here's an example. So inheritance is worse than composition.
So composition, on the left side you see inheritance. For example, A inherits from B, and O is an instance of A.
So in this case, we get
the O, the object O.
It has the functionality of B and A. I mean, the functionality from B can be used, is present in O. So object O has all the features of the B.
This is bad, they say. It's better to do it differently, like
composition. In this case, we make two objects. Object B is the instance of B, so the functionality is there. And here in A, instead of inheriting the functionality from B, we just make an attribute of the class B inside A. You can read, first link is the link to Stack Overflow with a huge discussion about this subject. They have probably like a few hundred answers there. Like a long discussion about this problem. You can see the links to the blog post and everything. And then my blog post. The second link is my blog post. I wrote it again about 5 years ago, which is saying that inheritance is a technique for procedural. It's something that we have from the procedural world. So I believe, my opinion is that inheritance is something that should not exist in object-oriented programming.
But instead, there should be subtyping. So the difference
between subtyping and inheritance, you can read on Wikipedia, there are two different things. The first thing is subtyping, which is very good, which is about this hierarchy. This is subtyping. So this hierarchy doesn't say anything about implementation of those students and implementation of this person and everything. Those are just types. So we're just saying that a student is a person and the graduate is a student. But then people made a mistake, in my opinion. They started to use this inheritance, this subtyping, to use for reusing the functionality of objects.
So they said, hey, look, if the student is not a type,
but actually a concrete implementation, so why the graduate cannot have the same functionality as a student, implement the same implementation as the student has? And that's how we got into implementation inheritance. So we have subtyping and implementation inheritance. Probably it's too much information for you, so those of you who are interested in object-oriented programming, you definitely should read about the difference. It's actually the Wikipedia page about this, about subtyping and implementation inheritance. There are two different things. Subtyping is only about telling us who is who, and implementation inheritance is about where do we get the implementation for my class. And most people think, when they start using Java after like other languages, or just they get introduced to object-oriented programming, they just
look at the class and say, oh, they have these very nice methods there,
which already exist. How do I have them in my class as well?
And the best way, okay, extend it.
And then you have my class, which has exactly the same functionality. And then I could put some extra functionality on top, and boom, I have a larger class, which is more powerful. Great. But it's not great. So it shouldn't work like this. So ideally, I think that Java and other languages, they should not have this feature at all, implementation inheritance. Then our world will be much better.
Sorry, but what you would propose to use instead?
Composition. Composition, always composition. It's not only me proposing, there are tons of articles about that, yeah.
What's the problem with implementation?
Why implementation inheritance is bad? Yeah, why it's bad? Okay, the practical reasons you can, of course, find on this first link. First of all, it leads to
the code, which is difficult to understand. So when you look at the class, you see the features there,
but you don't understand where are the other features, and you need to go to another class to find out where they exist. That's like one of the obvious problems.
Another problem could be the
intersection between the functionality provided by the parent class and the functionality provided by the child class. And very often people make those parent classes open for extension. So for example, they make an abstract class where something is implemented and something is not. And when we extend the class, with the make a child class, then we start implementing those missing pieces.
But in the parent class, the implemented pieces call those things. They refer, they rely on them.
And then when you call the functionality inherited, it starts calling the functionality provided here, and it turns into a mess. because people who designed that class, they didn't know how you would implement this functionality. So you basically make fragile solutions, which the code from here relies on the code you provide later, and they break. That together, the whole package breaks. That's one of the practical reasons for.
But this way, we also lose a polymorphism.
Polymorphism. No, the polymorphism goes here.
Polymorphism exists because we have subtyping. So I'm not saying we should not have inheritance. So keep in mind, there's two different things. Subtyping is okay, but implementation inheritance is something else. So this is the tree of types. This is the hierarchy of types. And then let's say I need to implement the graduate. I implement it, but I cannot take the functionality from the student. I need to implement everything from scratch. That's the idea.
Yes, but like in current implementation, like I understand the difference between those concepts.
Yeah.
But in how to implement nowadays, it's just it's we have to choose one way or another.
Nowadays, in most cases, people use inheritance.
That's it. You don't choose. You just go for implementation inheritance. But in a better world, I'm trying to teach you a better world, and not only me. I'm saying there's tons of literature about that.
They will tell you that try to
stay away from inheritance. So use composition instead. So if you need, for example, you need to implement this undergraduate here. You need to implement graduate, and you feel that you need the functionality of a student. So you cannot make extends. You make the instance of a student and encapsulate it, make it an attribute. And that's how you get the functionality of a student. But don't extend. Don't use the word extend. So the key word in Java, extends, is the problem.
So subtyping
is implemented through composition? No. Composition is the method of reusing the code which you already have. So look at this picture. I need the feature of B
inside A. So how do I do this?
An instance of B and put it inside my A. Here, I just inherit from there. So, how can we implement subtyping? Subtyping is implemented through types in Java, through interfaces. So just a tree of interfaces where interfaces, you know, look like this. So this is the structure which you define in Java using only interfaces, no classes, just interfaces. It's just a definition of contracts. We're just saying that a student is a person. A student is a person. No code here. We don't write any code. We don't implement the student. We don't implement the person. We just say a student is a person. And then we start implementing them. And when we start implementing, we don't do extend. We just we take the composition, we take the functionality by making them attributes.
But in case of the composition in parentheses in Java, so we have a huge amount of code where the child class is calling the necessary class in such a way of place where it has control students to all hierarchy of classes.
Yes, about the speed, of course, that's a very very
common question, like sometimes this inheritance may work faster comparing to composition. But that's a trade-off we need to make sometimes to keep the code more maintainable. But like I make an example earlier, if you look at the Linux core source code, you will see many, many places where they use go-to statement. All of you know probably that go-to is a bad statement, right? You need to know. You have to know.
Who doesn't know that go-to is a bad statement?
Everybody knows.
So I don't think that it's always bad. There are cases where...
There you go. Yes.
And actually, the Linux kernel was written in C, and there it's pretty hard to do some stuff without go. For example, there are kind of mess. So I think it is kind of okay there.
So the key reason why go-to is used in Linux kernel usually is because it's faster, it works faster. So the code looks
less structured because go-to actually breaks the structure.
If you have the embedded structure of instructions and then you do go-to from somewhere, then of course it's difficult for somebody who read the code to understand what's going on.
But it works faster.
So if you go to Linux and suggest them the improvement, remove the go-to and make the code look nicer, they will reject your pull request, your patch. Because they will say, look, it will be slower. Yes, we know the
code will look better, but it will work for a few nanoseconds slower.
We don't want that. So the same here. We know that composition may be a little bit slower sometimes, but we do it because we believe that the design will be better. So need to know the trade-off. Of course, if at some point they will ask you to make a
very fast system, extremely fast,
then you go for whatever you go. Go to statement, whatever.
Solid principles. You said you know what they are.
First, a very nice quote from, again, Robert Martin. He says that agile developers, they are like surgeons. So they rely a lot on the quality of the procedure. So they when they do the design, they're like surgeons. They clean up their instruments. They make sure that the way they design software is very sterile, and that's why the result is good. So I
put this quote here in order to convince you,
in order to encourage you to listen to these design principles, which I will share with you now, which some of you already know. So design principles are very important. One way is when you do the surgery the way you want, and another way you do the surgery using the knowledge by other people, which is 20 years old.
Solid principles, they go for
single responsibility principle, open-close principle, Liskov substitution principle, interface segregation principle, and dependency inversion principle. Which of this you think is the most important? Which one? First one. Single responsibility. That's right. I would also say the same, even though I don't understand what it means. But let's see.
A few words about Robert Martin. I keep telling you about him, and you still don't know who he is, so...
Please pay attention. He is very active on this blog, cleancoder.com, and he's very active on Twitter. So if you have Twitter account, just follow him. He tweets every day something interesting, very smart guy. And he actually he made a huge contribution to the industry, to the area of software development. I would not say he's a scientist. I would not say he's a researcher. I would not say he's a practical programmer either, because I don't know any big products which he created. Maybe in open source or anywhere, so I don't say that he's really a programmer making, like Linus Torvalds, for example, who is making products, but he wrote a lot of books as very good advice for us. So you definitely need to know about this guy. He invented these principles,
which everybody right now, all software development teams,
all software developers, they listen to. So he actually made a huge contribution. Single responsibility principle.
It sounds like a class should have only one reason to change,
no matter what it means. Or each module should be responsible for each role. I don't know what it is. Every module, class, or function should have responsibility over a single part of that functionality and should encapsulate that part. I wrote a blog post where, like 4 years ago, where I said that a single responsibility is like a fake idea. Because what I mean here is that it's a simple, in simple words, explaining to us
a very complex idea. The very complex idea is
that we need to design our system the way that the module, each module, is small enough to represent a certain concept. But you cannot make it a principle, that's my thought. You cannot make it a one-line principle, because nobody really understands what it means should have one reason to change. Like, what, how exactly is that? One reason to change, what is the reason? It's a bug? Or, I mean, it's hard to explain. I tried it many times. But overall, he's right. Overall, he's right, but the formulation of this principle, I think it's quite simplistic. It's very primitive. But the whole idea is right. We need to do software the way that each module is responsible for one specific area of concern. But if, for example, you're designing a database connection, then make sure this database connection is not responsible for example, logging. Do another component which does the logging. Or for example, you make a rectangle on the screen. So make sure this rectangle is only responsible for drawing a rectangle, not for saving the rectangle to the database. So don't mix concerns in one object. This is what this single responsibility is about. So when you have one object, make sure this object does what the title of the object says. It's rectangle. Okay, I'm the rectangle. I know something about my square. I know about my coordinates, and I know how to print me on the screen, for example. but I don't know how to save it to the database. I don't know how to log. I don't know how to calculate the, I don't know, the color or something like that. So don't put too much on me. My responsibility is drawing the rectangle. How exactly in your code you will define this responsibility, single responsibility principle, that's a separate question. I don't know. I don't have an answer. Every time it's going to be something different. Every time it's going to be a different story. But keep in mind, single responsibility. The object is responsible for one specific area of concern.
This is the graph. This is the like the image picture of
image representation of this idea. So let's say we have accounting. In the accounting territory, we have pay calculator. We have in the operations, we have how hours report, and then we have employee saver. So we don't mix them together. We don't make one object. We have three objects. One object for accounting, one object for operations, one object for IT. But some people do it together in one object. So when you have a class, when you see a class which has more than five methods, then make sure the single responsibility is broken there. So the class has to have three, four methods, maximum, top. That's my opinion. That's the metric. That's the number you can use, the practical number. If your class has more than four methods, okay, more than five, then you're in trouble. Then you're doing something wrong. You probably violate this principle. Your class is responsible for too many things.
Next principle is called open-close principle. Open-close, software entities should be open for extension but closed for modification. Who knows what it means? I can tell you what it means.
It means that, like we discussed, it means that if you have an object, a class, then you don't make it abstract with something methods missing. So every time I take your code, your class, for example, I am not allowed to do something, to place anything into the class, like extend it, and then with my functionality, with my extra functionality, change the functionality you implemented before. So your classes, software entities, it could be a class, a component, should be open for extension, but closed for modification. So anyone can take me, my module, extend it, like add some functionality on top of that, but nobody can modify what's inside me. This is a very good example. This abstract class is a very good example. When people make abstract class, and then inside this abstract class, they leave some methods abstract as well. Who knows Java knows what I'm talking about. So that, like I do three methods, they're final, and then one method is abstract. It means that anybody can extend me, for example, this calculator. The calculator has four methods, and then I do one scientific calculator, adds more methods. The business calculator adds more methods, but none of them override existing methods. So if I, for example, put
the method sub to this class,
that would be the violation of the principle. So there is no violation on this picture because I only add new functionality. I don't modify the existing one. If I would override the method add or method sub, that's the violation of the principle. So the bottom line, to obey this principle, always make your classes and methods final. That's it. Your class is final. Your method is final. And you will be fine. This is what this principle is about. Yeah, that's the violation. That's a violation of the principle, yeah. So if you override the method in Java, you violate this principle. You technically can do that, but Robert Martin is not happy about that. Say again? Yeah, that's a violation. Abstract class is a violation of this principle. Class should not be abstract. I mean, it should, if it's abstract, of course, if it's abstract,
all of its methods has to be final.
Abstract class, final. But what's the point of this class? That's a different question.
What do you mean by
final method means the method which cannot be overwritten. In Java, it's the explicit keyword for that.
One
That's okay. That's okay. Yeah, it's okay. Yes, that's extension. It's not modification. Yeah, that's okay. Yeah. So if you, I repeat the question. So if you have the base class, and the base class will have some method, and then you have a child class which extends this class, and then in this class you have the same method, and this method calls that one with some maybe extra parameters, then it's okay. It's not okay to extend, the, to modify the class. Like let's say you have this method there, and then you override this method in the child class. The, over, the overriding of methods is prohibited by this class.
If in our parent class this method is not defined, it's okay to override?
No. If it's not defined. But then you're not overriding if it's not defined.
Define it, but not implemented.
No, you, if you define it but not implemented, it's not allowed. That you violate the principle. So you, because you modify the class. So you have the class, and this class something is defined but not implemented, and then you make a child class, and then you implement it. So in this case, with this implementation, you change the, you modify the class right there with your, you copy what's there, and then you start modifying the functionality which is coming from there. So that's the violation.
Next one, Liskov substitution principle. Liskov is the name, is the last name of Barbara Liskov, a very famous researcher in the area of object orientation, object-oriented programming. The principle sounds like this. If for each object,
blah, 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 it's a long story, but the bottom line is subtyping. This principle is about subtyping. So if you want a chair, I can give you the white chair and that will be okay for you. This is the principle. So we should not, we, the, you,
if you accept the chair, you should also accept white chair.
Which is quite reasonable for object-oriented programming. And I don't even know why it's the, why it's, this one is part of this solid principles. Like it sounds like common sense to me. It's like the core idea of Java. Like, yes, this is how it works. So I don't know, but you need to know about this. If you won't read about this, this is funny, duck typing. Who knows what is duck typing? Oh, good.
So duck typing is basically the idea in object-oriented.
In programming, I'm not sure about object, but in programming, it says that, you know, typing, there, the usually there are types exist in programming. So I say, I want a chair. In this case, I say,
there's a type, we call it a chair.
I expect you to provide me something of the type chair. And then that's an explicit definition of typing. So we define somewhere what is the chair, and then I say, look, this is the description of a chair. This is the type. Give me the chair. Duck typing means that we don't declare anything.
That what is a chair, but as long as something comes in, if I can sit on it.
Oh, that's a chair. If you give me a table, and I can also sit on it, and say that's a chair as well for me. So for me, whatever behaves like a chair works for me. Whatever,
you know, looks like a dog, swims like a dog, walks like a dog, and it's a dog. So I don't, the practice in programming, in some programming languages, duck typing.
Which say, some programming languages, they have that, where you don't declare types up front, you just give whatever it is. In Ruby, for example, in JavaScript. It doesn't matter what you give to JavaScript as an object, whatever, if I call the object and it responds to me, then this is the perfect object for me. So you submit me
something and I say, for example, give me the
size of you. Is it an array? It will give me the size. It's a string. It will give me a size. It's a screen. It will give me a size. It's a database. It will give me the size. Whatever. It will give me the size. I just say get size. I don't care what's there. This is duck typing. Which is very weak, I mean, it's not so strong approach to programming because it creates a lot of problems potentially, but you need to know what it is. It's called duck typing.
And the last, not the last, the one before last principle, it's called...
Interface segregation principle. That's very interesting. Clients should not be forced to depend on methods that they do not use. Here's the picture. Let's take a look at this picture. I like it. Let's say we have one user, user one, user two, user three. User one wants operation one, another user wants operation two, another user wants operation three. For example, the user one wants the operation from the class. So the user is looking, user is a class, and they're looking for, oh, you don't see what's going on, huh? So the user is looking for, like one class is talking to another class and wants to get some functionality. The very common approach for programmers is to provide this functionality in the class like a method, and then when somebody else comes in to me, then I add more methods to my class, more and more and more and more. In the end, we have so bloated classes with so many methods in there, then sometimes those classes are like, I don't know, 50 different methods or 100 different methods, because I have so many clients, and to satisfy all of these clients, I just keep adding more and more and more methods. What happens in the end? A new client comes in, it opens my class,
and there are 50 different methods right there.
And the client need to deal somehow with these methods. Like they start becoming dependent on this API, like a full huge API which they don't need. So they come, the new client comes in for one method, maybe two methods, but we already give them 50 because we gave those 50 for previous 50 clients. Well, that's a wrong idea. The better idea is that for each client, we design a small interface, the small front end for our functionality. And through this front end, the client comes through. So in this case, the client depends on a very small part of the API. Like this is one method for you only. You talk to me, you get this functionality. How I implement this method, that's my problem. Maybe I will have a huge class on the back end which implements 50 methods and all of them are connected to this interfaces. But for clients, we usually try to provide small interfaces. If you look at the modern API libraries from large companies, Google, Amazon, Oracle, they all violate this principle. That's the massive violation of the principle. Look at the Android API. Look at the Amazon AWS, Amazon Web Services API. It's a mess. They provide classes with hundreds of methods. Now, today, in 2021, this principle was published like 20 years ago. You're asking me about books. They're outdated. They're not outdated. Amazon is outdated. Robert Martin is not outdated. Look at the APIs. Look at Android API. A huge interface, like
a large class with like, I don't know, 145 methods.
Who works with Android knows what I'm talking about. Who ever tried to work with Amazon API, Amazon AWS, AWS? Just 1, 2, 3, 5 people. So you probably know what I'm talking about. The API. You open just a class,
and there is like a boom, a list of methods. And you look at them. This is how companies now design APIs.
And this is completely wrong. Like read what was said a long time ago. And if you go to their offices and say, "Do you follow solid principles?" Everybody will say, "Absolutely. We love them. Absolutely. Solid principles." They will ask you at the interview, "Do you know what solid principles are?" And if you don't answer, you're not hired. But then if you look at the products they make, they have no idea what these principles are. So according to this principle, we have to have many, many, many small classes. For Amazon, for example, like the interface for the service, for EC2, for example, for EC2 to rent a server. It has to be many micro interfaces, many micro classes, and each class like 1, 2 methods. Instead, they give us 100 methods. So think about this. When you design the API, you have to design it the way this principle dictates. Interface segregation. So for each request, there has to be specific interface, very small, not a large API.
Next one, the last one, dependency inversion principle. We'll talk a little bit about it in a few minutes.
But in general, it sounds like high-level modules should not depend on low-level modules. Both should depend on abstractions. Abstractions should not depend on details. Details should depend on abstractions. Where should be a picture? Yeah, it's about this. Again, you don't see, huh?
So we have
the object on the left, the blue one, depends on the object, the green one. This is bad.
They suggest a better design.
The green object. The blue object depends on a blue interface, and the interface is implemented by the green object. So they basically, in general, suggest that there are no concrete dependencies between two objects. I think the principle is about that. High-level modules should depend on low-level modules. Both should depend on abstractions. So dependence on abstractions, that's the key word. Do not depend on specifics. Depend on abstractions. Don't ask for a white chair. Don't ask for a chair with four legs. Ask for general a chair. And ask that this chair you provide must be capable of sitting on it. That's all I need. Don't tell these customers, so don't connect to classes. So every time, try to design interfaces. So every time, let's say you design a class, and in the class you say, there's my method, and in the method you say, I accept the parameter of type user. And if this user is a class, then you're making something wrong. That's wrong. This user should be interface. So that tomorrow I come in and I implement my user for you. And then somebody else come in and implement their user for you. So you don't accept only one specific user. You always accept an interface. And who implements this interface and how this interface will be implemented, that's up to them.
That's the idea of this dependency.
Dependency, чего-то там, inversion principle. Dependency inversion principle. Or maybe, yeah. Okay, that's it. Read about that.
Now we get to design by contract. I cannot say too much about that because you know the author of this. So the idea is that you
design the object the way that you explain what's expected before the object and what we assume that will happen after the object. So there are preconditions and there are postconditions. It's a very interesting concept. Unfortunately, it's not implemented in many programming languages for a number of reasons. Probably it's difficult, but it is implemented in some languages. Maybe it will be the future. I mean, it may be hard to implement that in Java, even though it's possible to make some validations of parameters, maybe, but I'm not sure about the control of preconditions and postconditions. But you can think about this and try to learn more about it. I had to say about it because it's quite interesting design concept.
Another one is called don't repeat yourself, try. I found this
picture for you. That's all I can say about it. I think it's quite obvious. So when you write your code, make sure you do not write, like Robert Martin says, not a single line of code you can write twice. So if you see that you write the same line of code anywhere, that's it, you're doing it wrong. I'm not talking about making a copy of a 50 lines of code somewhere else and say, hey, cool, it works here, and then it's gonna work as well here. But even one single line, so the moment you feel that I written it somewhere, it existed somewhere else in my code, then something is wrong. So make changes and extract that line somewhere, call it a function, call it an object, something like that. But never, ever repeat yourself. That's one of the key problems in software development. It's copy-paste. When you take copy, and then why it's wrong, you can imagine. Why? Because then these two pieces of code, they start living their own life. One goes one way, another one goes another way, and you can never get them back. And then when you realize that there was a bug,
you start fixing this bug and that bug in one place.
And then you don't know what's the other place. So your fixes diverge, and in the end, the whole code is a mess.
Next one, YAGNI principle, you ain't gonna need it.
Chapter 5, it says, do you know what it means? Yeah. Yes? Can anyone say what it means? Yeah. Or it's a question. Okay, go ahead. What is YAGNI? Who knows what this principle is? Yes?
You probably wouldn't want to write the code that won't be used later.
Right. So you don't write the code which you don't need now, but you will need later. So you see, I found this picture on the internet. They say feature 1 is today, feature 4 is today, and features 3, 2, and 5.
Currently not needed, but based on some assumptions, we will implement them anyway because it's a nice feature to have. So you don't do that. We talked about this, about design, right? So you don't make complexity,
you don't make your design more complex and more sophisticated than you need it right now. So this is YAGNI principle, which is, I don't think we need to talk about this much more, it's just a principle. Inversion of control, this is interesting, inversion of control.
So how does inversion of control
works? I have my own understanding of how it works, which may be a little bit wrong from what you read from the books, but in my understanding, it's quite simple. So this is the quote from my blog. Take a look at the code. Look at this code. It says print book.title. So in this case, what happens? Before I go to the method print, I get the book, I take the title, and then I give the title to the print method. This is pretty straightforward execution with no inversion. I prepare the data for the method print and I send the data. Another approach, which I think is called inversion of control, I give the book to the method print, and then the method print will come to the book and ask for the title. So it's going to be the inversion of control.
I don't control when it's going to happen. I lose control.
When I give the book there, I lose control. I don't know what's going to happen. At some point of time, the method print will come inversely to the book and call the method. So that's inversion of control. So we have the straight control flow. I control everything. I build the data for you. I call the book. I prepare. I push you everything. And I know what you're doing step by step.
Or I give you the book and I just lose control.
I don't know when exactly you will call my object. Or maybe you will never call the object. So that's inversion of control. Quite simple. And I think it's good. I think inversion of control is quite a good approach. It's much better than the first line. So the second line is better because we let those guys deal with our objects. I kind of lose control and that's good. I'm thinking now why it's good. I mean, yeah, I need to explain you why it's good.
I think it's good because we
extract less data, we extract less control out of objects. I mean, but anyway, this title will be called anyway somewhere. So the method title will be called. It's going to happen anyway. So probably it's not a good reason. But
in general, I would suggest that you use this inversion of control. In a more classic example, if you go for inversion of control, they will
tell you about this dependency injection container. And they say that usually in a classic example, it's not going to be the book, it's going to be in dependency injection container. So it's like a holder of objects. It's like a bag of objects.
Which you pass there, you pass there, you pass there. You just go with this bag of objects, with this container of objects. You give this container to all the places. And these places, they will get their objects from the container and use them when they want. So this is the classic inversion of control idea, which I don't like. This idea I don't like. So having a container of objects
and moving this container from one place to another, I think it's a violation of many object-oriented principles because you don't know which objects will be taken from there, and that's not good. Service locator anti-pattern. Yeah. I think service locator is anti-pattern. Yeah, anti-pattern. Yeah, I think so. Injection container, service locator, those are, in my opinion, anti-patterns.
Next one, object-oriented programming versus functional programming.
So who of you are functional programmers? Raise your hand. One.
C++
doesn't count. Templates. Yeah?
I mean, who of you are really functional programmers? No. Okay, then I can say whatever I want, right? Because you will not catch me. Because I'm not a functional programmer. Well, I wrote some code in Lisp when I was younger. I wrote something in Clojure a few years ago. I wrote a few
I wrote myself a compiler of functional programming language. It's very easy. I think the easiest task for a programmer is to create a compiler for Lisp. That's probably that you can do in like, I mean, 1 hour.
So for Java, I ask you to write a compiler for Java, that will take, you know, something like Java, that will take you, weeks. The right to compile for Lisp?
It's just half an hour of work, maybe 1 hour. It's very easy. Because the syntax, because it's functional programming.
So Uncle Bob, the same Uncle Bob, this is what he said about functional programming. That's I took it from his book. So look what's going on. In object-oriented programming, we have this principle, and all his principles. Principles, patterns, design patterns. What do we have in functional programming? So object-oriented programming has so many different things, so many different concepts, paradigms, principles. It's so heavy. Functional programming is extremely simple. Just functions. Huh? Yeah. Just functions. Everywhere is functions. It's hard to write. It's much harder to write code if you're not really a functional programmer. But if you understand the concept of functional programming, you will be absolutely. It will be a lot of fun for you. So coding will be a lot of fun for you. Functional programming. So I really recommend you to to learn functional programming. First of all, you will learn it in probably one day. And second, you will be able to write code the next day. And of course, your code will do nothing useful, because in functional programming, to make a useful application in functional programming, that will take you much, much longer than for me to create a compiler for this. But you will have fun playing with it. So functional programming is good to play with. Eventually, if you play for quite long, you may become functional programming, who are paid much more functional programmers. They are much more, consider themselves programmers of the next level, like elite programmers. Yeah, seriously. And so I very much recommend you to try. That's what I know about functional programming. And the final slide. If you read the text there, and you probably should, I can say what people think about object-oriented programming. So we talked today about object-oriented analysis and design. And I can tell you, it is a mess. And big guys, they say the same thing.
Dijkstra, who died some long time ago, he said that object-oriented programs are offered an alternatives to correct ones. So there are object-oriented programs and correct ones. That's what this guy said. And you probably know who he is. And then Alan Kay, who actually invented the name object-oriented programs, object orientation, he said,
I invented the term object-oriented, and I can tell you,
I did not have C++ in mind. So the author of object-oriented idea says that C++ is far away from the idea, and Java as well, and all other languages.
And you can find many, you can Google this, you can
go to my blog post. I actually, in this blog post, I put many, many quotes from big people who are saying the same. So object-oriented programming today is a mess. And that's why so many programmers are now moving from object-oriented to functional programming. So if you can Google it, you can find the statistics. So more and more people are moving from OOP to FP, to functional programming, because it's a mess.
Because like I said, because the idea was abstract.
It was high level idea. Encapsulation is great. Abstraction is great. Inheritance is great. Polymorphism is great. And then people started making languages like C++. And they made horrible mistakes. Many, many mistakes. And then programmers come in who have no idea what's going on. And they started coding because we need to code. We need applications. And then we created a total mess there.
So how to fix that, if you're interested to fix, we actually have a project.
Running here in Innopolis, like real project, where we're trying to fix this mess a little bit. So who of you may be interested to work in a real project and write code and help us to fix object-oriented programming, come to me, we'll talk, and maybe we'll find you a place, and maybe we'll do something together.
Okay, then I quickly give you the suggestions. Two books, the one book, Clean Code, another one, Object-Oriented Analysis and Design. Then I suggest you to read Bjorn Straustrup about C++. You have to read it. It's a huge book. Be careful. Object-oriented head first. Very good book. The conference where to publish. This is called Splash Now. There's a conference on system programming languages and application. Call to action. Analyze one of your apps which you've written. That's a good idea. Homework. Take one application, something, some code which you've written before. Look at it. And find out which design principles you violated and which design principles you obeyed in your code. Identify those principles. Unresolved issues in the area of functional or object-oriented programming. The first question is how to fix object-oriented programming. Second one, how to force object orientation on the man. Third one, how to eliminate root causes of violations. And number four, how to make better programming languages. Think about this. This is my final slide. How can we make better programming languages so that they will be help us create better software and not violate the principles? Thanks for coming. See you in 2 weeks.